I will only present the obvious. Most of us think what our own tribe has taught us to think, without really stopping to check if it's valid. So please, forget your opinions for half an hour, and be open to have a new look at what I think is absolutely obvious. Thank you. This talk will be a little bit futuristic. It will happen in some years. It doesn't matter if you follow everything, as long as you get the main idea. I will present this little futuristic toy we are developing. It's called Thing. Please remember that it's only a premature prototype named Thing 1. I want to show you what it does. I'll put some things into this little bowl of soup that I always carry with me. Please watch. As the process is still very slow, we have prepared a much speeded up clip of it. Please watch. You can see Thing grows. It releases some bubbles. Watch now. Thing splits into two things. It cloned itself. Maybe it's boring as a toy, but it's not really a toy. Thing is actually the cutting edge of today's nanotechnology. Inside this small package, there are currently more than 2,000 types of nanomachines, all in huge numbers. That's equivalent to most of the pharmaceutical industry in Europe. That's the power of nano. Most machines are just one huge molecule that changes its shape upon activation by another molecule. Basically, what Thing does is this. It caters for specific molecules in the soup, breaks them into pieces, and constructs new molecules from them. Then it uses those to build an exact clone of itself. All is powered by energy that it extracts from soup molecules. Now, that may sound easy, but let's take a closer look at the complexity of this process. So let's start with the materials. Thing absorbs from the soup all of the raw materials needed to power and to build the clone of itself. There are pump machines built into Thing's membrane, and they are built to fit only the correct molecules and pump them in. They are powered either by the drawn molecule or by a special energy carrier molecule from within Thing. We'll talk about that soon. Now we come to the power plant. Thing needs power to run all of its machines, so it creates a kind of a chemical electrical battery. So electrons from soup molecules, actually food, are pumped by a line of machines to one side of a membrane. You can see here the machines at work, and they form an electric battery. And this battery then powers a nano-electric motor, and the motor operates a power turbine. And this turbine produces ATP power packages, the blue and purple molecules, that can be transported to every part of Thing. ATP molecules are the energy carrier in Thing. So let's stop for a minute. What do we have? We have an autonomous machine that replicates itself out of energy and molecules that it gathers. There's a word for this. Life. That's what life is, nothing more.
What's in the tube? Microscopic nanobots.
The next important aspect I want to talk about is the modular construction system. Thing is built only from atoms it can absorb from its direct surroundings. The main mass comes from air and water. So it's O, H, C, and N. Thing breaks them up and then reassembles the atoms to build a modular system of building blocks called amino acids. These are the Lego parts from which all of Thing is then constructed. The amino acids are then joined as long chains, which are then folded to create machine parts for various functions. Let's all relax and look at some folding. Here is one dynamic example. And here, this incredible machine. It's a transporter which delivers packaged molecules to the destination within Thing. It goes step by step, powered by ATP molecules. Look at this. It travels on a network of constructed tubular highways. Now let's look closer at the main turbine. It's called ATPase. There are thousands of these within each thing. It's electrically powered to produce chemical energy packages called ATP. You see, the rotation moves these submachines, and they anchor two molecules, ADP and the phosphate group, and they force them together to produce an ATP energy package. The turbine is driven by this electric motor, running on protons from the battery we saw before. The pink ones are the protons. The next important base of thing is the operating system. All operation is induced by a programmed operating system. It's written in a 4-digit machine language, and in itself, it's expressed by a chain of molecules called DNA. Here are machines made of folded protein, and they copy segments of code from the DNA, and they transfer it to other protein machines, which translate it into the desired chain. Here in red are amino acids forming a protein strand, which then folds on itself. So this is how machines are built. Next is pharma industry. We have production lines for synthesizing and decomposing molecules, hundreds of machines working together in production lines. So let's quickly summarize the main systems within Thing. We have mining, getting air, water, and some other molecules. We have power plant, the battery and the ATPase. We have a modular construction system, organic building blocks, protein chains. We have an operating system written in 4 digits into the DNA. We have this huge pharma industry, and we have a transportation system that we did not even look into. So thing one is as complicated as a self-sufficient economy, including all these systems that we saw. And they have to work together. If they don't all work perfectly, thing fails. If one system doesn't function, it cannot grow, it cannot replicate, there's no life. Obviously, and I remind you, we're talking only about the obvious here, to achieve a complete thing, we needed many, many working hours of many, many smart people, a lot of intelligence. That's called intelligent design. So now let's look at another great system that we have incorporated in Thing 1. It's called EVO 1. EVO 1 is a quality control system incorporated in the DNA, which checks its integrity before allowing the cloning process to complete. So EVO is turned on only at the stage when the DNA is duplicated. Now note this, the system is designed to allow certain changes in the cloned DNA. We will soon see what that is good for. So the coding for a protein assembly from amino acids might change, but the programming language instructions for the gene cannot change. Let's look at an example. It's called the lac operon. The lac operon are genes that their task is to produce lactose breakers, molecules that break lactose, only when there is lots of lactose and low glucose. The programming phrase is as follows. So the blue words are program language, and EVO will not let them change. The red words represent quantities, and EVO will promote variations in them. The white words are proteins, and they can slightly change. And here is what it's good for. Different clones of thing might have, for example, different numbers of copies of the whole lac operon, or only parts of it, thus reacting to different concentrations of lactose. And, of course, the optimal will survive. Most changes are allowed within the programming for body plan. Mainly how many building blocks and machines will be used at any specific site within thing at any specific time. So this is regulation of quantities, size, shape, regulation of materials, etc. In accordance with that, changes in the DNA may include some mutation and a lot of DNA recombination and duplication. So again, the idea behind EVA1 is a great achievement of some of the great brains that designed Thing. Each generation of cloned things will include a certain amount of variations. The best fitted will best survive in its environment and go on auto-cloning. So evil system will make things able to fine-tune itself to adapt to many environments and to pressures of changing environment.
This, the nanobots have gotten more complex.
What stats you say? Those robots evolved all by themselves, you say?
It wasn't by themselves. I put them there. I'm a genius. Get over it.
Hey, look, now they got bigger.
Good heavens, trilobots!
Oh no, my sunglasses were in there.
So as Thing 1 can fine-tune itself, we can concentrate on the main thing, which is the next generation, Thing 2. The Green Revolution is the slogan. Thing 1 actually chemotrophs is quite amazing, although after you show it around, it gets quite boring. Nonetheless, the possibilities are endless. So the next generation will be taking it out of the soup, making it function on air and seawater, and later on Earth. When it's out of the soup, it's enough to put one thing on a planet and theoretically it will multiply forever, doing what it does metabolically. In this way, you can even change a planet completely, including its rock, its atmosphere, etc. So this is a very powerful toy. So some completely new machinery should be designed. First priority, a solar power plant. Instead of the chemical battery of Thing 1 that is good only in soup conditions. We have to design a new type of solar collector, it's called photosystem. This machine will be completely different from Thing 1. A completely new component will be introduced. If it's not built perfectly, it does not function at all. Therefore, it cannot evolve over time to reach perfection. It's a completely new concept for energy source. Likewise, there is no evidence of any evolution of photosystems. They're today the exact machines that they were 3 billion years ago. Okay, so Thing's concept is modular design. This will enable us to change only the needed subsystem modules with new ones. So photosystem will be plugged into the existing electric potential devices. This means that in every new version of Thing, you will always see the good machinery from older versions. That's why continuous upgrades will form an evolutionary tree, as we know it. Upgrades are apparent as what we call horizontal gene transfer, which is a significant phenomenon in the development of species. I hope you got the idea, as I will continue rushing. Photosystems are made of protein complexes which enter a kind of a resonance caused by photons, by light, until they emit electrons. The raw material is water, turned into oxygen and free protons and electrons. These, separated by membrane, will form the old electrochemical battery. The oxygen will be freed into the atmosphere. Thing 2 is actually cyanobacteria. And this incredible machinery is the energy supplier for most life forms, up to date. It's the same in all creatures and plants that do photosynthesis. Wow, what a word. That's the ultimate green revolution. No evolution here. It's an upgrade. Thing 2 will include a significant upgrade for the EVO system, EVO 2. We plan to accelerate the rate of adaptive change by shuffling DNA parts from two things with new machinery for recombination process. We call this process nano-sex. DNA is transferred from one thing to another. Then recombination machinery splits them up and mixes them in various ways. Red DNA and blue DNA come from the two parents, a new concept by itself. The next big problem we have is how to upgrade existing specimens of Thing 1. We will need an upgrade system that physically invades them and plants new code into their DNA. This can be partly achieved by recombination machinery. But we have something much better in mind, which is quite similar to computer viruses. Viruses are very efficient as upgrade vehicles, as they are built to replicate inside the host and then continue to distribute the upgrade. Ingeniously, viruses are only a piece of a program upgrade. All the rest is manufactured by the host's own machinery. The virus anchors to Thing, then inserts its program upgrade together with a mini program for replication of itself. It has a protein machine that sticks the viral DNA into that of Thing, thus completing the upgrade. We may see these as transposons in the DNA. Thing's own machinery then goes on to produce new copies of the virus. Which package the upgrade and then spread out to deliver it to more specimens of Thing. Now you get the idea. Let's look a little bit further into the future. Thing 2 fills the oceans. Its byproduct, O2, fills the atmosphere and oxidizes the solutes in the oceans, iron, rusts and sinks, etc. At this stage, Thing modifies its ambient in a way that endangers its own survival. The next generation should thus reverse the metabolic pathway, feed on O2 and emit CO2. For any long-term continuance of life, there is need for cycling of matter involving complementary types of organisms. So Thing 3 will be the first recycler. It will coexist with Thing 2 instead of replacing it. You can see here Thing 2 pumping in water, CO2 and photons from the sun. Using photosystems, it produces energy-rich sugar molecules and releases oxygen into the atmosphere. The best way to reverse the metabolic pathway, consume O and release C, would be for Thing 3 to feed on Thing 2 and remain with the net energy. So there will be new machinery for breathing. Thing 3 will be very efficient energetically. Fed by ready-made organic compounds, it will have much shorter pathways to protein synthesis. It's an heterotroph, an organism that breaks organic molecules or food. So the easy energy will enable it to do so many more things. It can spend this energy on additional new systems. Being a hunter, it needs means for sensing and for moving, and a program to merge direction as cause and result. The bacterial flagellum, tail, is an example of a moving device that includes a complicated electrical motor. It's the focus for heated debate between many people who refuse to see the obvious. Evo 3 or maybe 4 will be another big leap. Instead of shuffling DNA between two individuals, it will include inside Thing a backup DNA that comes from another individual. This way, the shuffling will be done within Thing as part of the replication process by meiosis. There will be control for shuffling only homologous parts, and the backup will serve as a template for DNA repair. So Evo 3 is really the foundation of sex. And so we come to the conclusion. Let's count what I see as the obvious. Life is simply a machine built to autonomously replicate itself from surrounding energy and molecules. The cell is intelligently designed. Any part of DNA that is part of a programming language is designed. Controlled evolution is one of the programmed mechanisms. It works mainly on body plan programming. Upgrades were and probably still are being made. Probably every new machine is an upgrade, and so is every significant change of body plan, such as the introduction of new organs. I want to stop here and emphasize my main point. Put away for a minute what your social circle has taught you, either of a creator God or of a creator evolution. Forget for a minute what group of people you belong to, who you are. Look just at the hard evidence, like the systems of the basic one-cell machine Thing, as you've seen them here.
I'm sure your logical conclusion will be quite similar to what I've presented here. I think that when you neutralize your preconditioning, it becomes quite the obvious story of life. Thank you. That concludes my main talk. A couple of derivatives I still want to mention. First, what does it all mean for the understanding of DNA? I mentioned body plan many times. You have all heard that the genes of a mouse are 99% similar to human genes. Now that's obvious, because we are made of similar materials. The differences are obviously in body plan, and this is not in the genes. It is probably hidden in what is mistakenly called junk DNA, and makes up 98% of the human genome. My personal knowledge is very limited, but I like guessing, so here is how I see it. Body plan upgrades should account for most evolution leaps, and thus are expected to be mainly in the junk parts of DNA rather than in the genes themselves. So look for upgrades through microRNA, cis-regulatory elements, repetition sectors, etc. A huge part of the DNA of a multicellular organism is formed out of repetitions of short segments. My guess is that this is a kind of accounting device for body plan. That's why they differ in each and every individual. Maybe they represent the number of cells in each tissue. And here is something else to think about that will give you some proportions. Those who do all that manufacturing of things are working hundreds of millions of years on every significant upgrade. Now look at us, at what we have achieved in only 5,000 years of intensive brain work. 5,000. Seems to me that we will easily accomplish what they have given only thousands of years to work. The last aspect I want to mention is the cultural meaning of this. I want to throw you away in completely different directions. Can we find in the DNA the logo of the producers? Are there many companies of them? Sure seems to be a variety of personal tastes. When is the next upgrade due? Will we be the next producers of upgrades? Now flying far away, will people invent new cults of scientific gods? Will it affect history, new religions, new wars? So basically what I'm saying is, look at the obvious, without being preconditioned, and it'll open your mind for many new ways in which to continue exploring. Thank you.
I now present my latest discovery, the amazing non-mechanical man, Homo Farnsworth.
Thank you. I must say, I'm so proud to see what you've blossomed into since I first created your ancestors.
What?
Well, I thought you knew. You all evolved from some filth-gobbling nanobots I designed. I dumped them in one of your ponds a few days ago.
But this is creationist talk.
So I'd like to know how many of you will reconsider their opinions after this talk. Nobody?